Good afternoon. Can I invite everyone to take their seats? Welcome to the Mailman School of Public Health's Grand Rounds on the Future of Public Health. I'm Linda Fried, and I have the honor of serving as the dean of this fabulous school. And today, we are in for a great treat. Grand Rounds is a once-a-month school-wide event that brings to our campus leaders in visionary leaders in public health and related fields, and is our opportunity to come together, to interact, to learn, to imagine, and to craft as a basis, following from these discussions, innovative and critical approaches and solutions to national and global public health challenges. And this year, we are tackling a very critical one. As you all know, last year, the Institute of Medicine and the National Research Council published a very important and concerning report about the state of health in our own country, saying that the United States is at the bottom of peer nations around the world in terms of health status. And so this school, which is so deeply dedicated to contributing solutions to population health, both in our own country and globally, has taken on as our theme for the year, taking action to address the U.S. health gap. The series, which I had the pleasure of co-organizing with Professors Ron Baer and Bruce Link, is a year-long journey together to hear from visionary leaders who are tackling different aspects of the U.S. health gap, and to learn from them to shape our own course forward in order to better, ever better contribute to solutions. The series was kicked off last month by Dr. Stephen Wolf, who chaired the Institute of Medicine National Research Council panel that wrote this report, U.S. Health in International Perspective, Shorter Lives, Poorer Health. The series will conclude in May with a school-wide discussion to set a course through which the school can amplify our impact on the U.S. health gap. For those of you who haven't been at Grand Rounds before, today's event will be as follows. Our speaker's roughly 50-minute talk will be followed by about a half hour of all audience dialogue around the issues that he stimulates. And then after that, I'm hoping you'll all join us outside for a reception. During the dialogue, I certainly hope that our students will feel impelled to ask a question or make a comment, as well as the faculty, including all of us, a focus on future directions for our school. Now, it's my pleasure to introduce today's speaker. Dr. Bobby Milstein is, to my mind, a visionary thought leader. There are others in the audience who just came in and told me they were here to hear a rock star, and so you can make your decision at the end of the talk. But Dr. Milstein has led our country and the world in thinking about complex systems thinking and methodology as foundational tools for 21st century public health science and practice. In fact, to my mind, he's so visionary that he ranks as the only person I've invited back twice to give Grand Rounds, because he gave Grand Rounds here 4 years ago, and we're thrilled that he accepted twice. Dr. Milstein is the director of ReThink Health, working in the areas of systems dynamic models and game-based learning, and building from there as a flagship initiative of the Ripple Foundation to serve as an incubator to support the emergence and application of new ways to accelerate the transformation of American health and health systems. His initiative works to change the health system into one where diverse stakeholder groups come together in unexpected ways to redefine solutions and bring them to action. In Bobby's role with ReThink Health, he has led the creation of the ReThink Health model that is working with leaders across the country to explore the likely impacts of policy interventions on health outcomes and costs. He is a visiting scientist at the MIT School of Management, where he leads the Hygieia Dynamics Policy Studio, which provides a forum for diverse actors to acquire the foresight and motivation needed to craft powerful responses to pressing priorities. Dr. Milstein previously worked at the Centers for Disease Control and Prevention, where he founded the Syndemics Prevention Network, chaired the agency's Behavioral and Social Science Working Group, and was the principal architect of the CDC's Framework for Program Evaluation. He is a co-founder of the annual NIH-CDC Institute on Systems Science and Health, and a co-developer of the Health-Bound Policy Simulation Game, as well as the Prevention Impact Simulation Model. In addition to his really important work in these realms, Dr. Milstein has already been quite important to the Mailman School's work. His Grand Rounds visit 4 years ago helped us frame, conceive, and initiate our own program planning on complex systems in public health, which many of you are now engaged in. So we're deeply grateful to him for that, as well as many other inspirations. Dr. Milstein's talk today is entitled Beyond Reform and Rebound: Frontiers for Rethinking and Redirecting Health System Performance. Bobby, we're thrilled you're here.
Well, it's always so troubling when the introduction takes longer than the talk, right? It's a complete joy to be back. I feel a special affinity for this venue. It was 4 years ago that I first met Laura Landy, who is the head of the Ripple Foundation, and ever since then I've been working about 15-hour days with her and many of our colleagues to pursue this idea of not just engaging out of habit in the way that we approach health system challenges, but consciously thinking and rethinking what we might be able to accomplish together. And so what I hope to do is tell you some stories about this work. I found very productive this the theme of, you know, what is it about the national predicament that we face, the status of being an outlier in the rest of the world, given how much we spend and how little we get for it. It doesn't matter what metrics you put on this graph, you get pretty much the same point. And so this is becoming an increasingly a pressing priority, and it begs the question, what are we going to do about it? And the emphasis today on, you know, what do we see as a future for a response to this is a provocative question. I hope we'll all get a chance to talk about it as I share a few reflections on it from my work. It's a glib point, but it's true that, you know, in one way, if you want to predict the future, then create it. And it's not too ambitious to say that public health history is such that we have championed enormous changes in society that have led to the health and well-being of children and workers and the environment and tobacco and expansion of civil rights and new frontiers. So the idea of creating a future that we most want to see is very much in the spirit of what we're doing. As a nation, however, it's impossible to stand here today and realize that we're in the midst of another thing that Lincoln had observed, that a house divided can't really stand very well. And so the prospect of working together as a nation to do great things seems pretty far out of reach at the moment. And I think I'm going to argue that we can't retreat from the ambition of doing great things and creating a future that would make a huge difference. At the same time, we have to be pragmatic about who the actors are and who's best positioned to take what kind of changes. Putting aside the pragmatics of partisan politics, there is also the idea that when we do big things, they don't always necessarily deliver the kind of impact that we hope at the start. This is a terrific article in Health Affairs from a while ago. Literally, the title is The Sad History of Healthcare Cost Containment. This is a summary of major efforts to change the way the health system functions, and from the point of view of cost, which in some ways summarizes the burden of disease and the intricacies of our delivery care, healthcare delivery system. And so each one of these eras of first investing in the infrastructure of Medicare and Medicaid and then concentrating on wage and price signals and voluntary efforts and managed care, each of them were met with some short-term impact, as you might expect, and then a rather rapid rebound, which none of us wanted to see and I dare say didn't necessarily expect each time. So this predicament of reform and rebound is ubiquitous. There's a terrific lecture in the 2009 Grand Round series that John Sturman did describing this tendency for complicated systems to either delay or dilute or completely defeat the well-intentioned or sort of logical actions of change agents within it. And there are very predictable reasons why this happens. It comes out of tunnel vision. It comes out of trying to solve one problem out of context of the wider system. Mental models that cause us to consider just a few issues and not necessarily anticipate what the secondary or further consequences may be. It comes out of just a disconnection with our own data and experience, and so we can entertain theories about how the world works without necessarily interrogating them against the data that might be well documented but is easily forgotten. It comes out of the failure to find ways to foresee how systems can work and to think through with our unaided mind how a cascade of consequences might unfold. And even if you get past those barriers, it comes sometimes out of just doing the easy thing, the straightforward thing, and the inability to act on areas that we know are much higher leverage but remain unaddressed. I just wanted to give a little quick example of this because the cycle of reform and rebound is continuing even now. There's a very active debate. This time series here, I know you can't see it, but it extends that historical story, which ended in the early 2000s, now right up until the present and projects it out into the future. And we see again this wave of cyclical change. And this is a hot topic. If any of you are interested in health economics and the conditions under which we can rein in cost and get better value for the money that we're spending. This is a topic that people at Harvard and Brookings and Urban Institute, the National Bureau of Economic Research, they're all weighed in on is the slowdown that we've been recently experiencing real, or is it likely to rebound again and under what conditions? And this is just a list of some of the forces that if you read these papers, as my colleague Jack Homer has done very closely, you see theories about, well, it's due to the recession, but only some fraction, and that fraction ranges from everywhere from 20-30% to upwards of 60-70%. So they're all over the map on to what extent does the economy drive our healthcare utilization. And then deeper theories about the business cycle or the role of uninsurance and now the likely impact of an expanding insurance pool, cost sharing arrangements, new approaches to patient demand and the degree to which investment capital flows into the market and builds the capacity for more utilization or technology, which is unequivocally a big driver. What was astonishing when you read these papers is just how few other forces people consider, like aging. Only one of these five major statements on this even considers the fact that we are still on the front edge of a major age wave, and that age wave is driving a lot of healthcare utilization and therefore cost. So to have only one scholar recognize this kind of glacial shift going on demographically is pretty astonishing. And then complete silence on epidemiology, the fact that there's a large pool of people with pre-diabetes who will eventually become diabetic and need more care, and just the interconnectedness of chronic disease and mental illness and the degree to which injuries and violence and environmental exposures are all having a toll on the eventual demand and eventual cost that will be reflected in future prices and future spending in healthcare. Risk and vulnerability, social policy and power, these are all modifiable forces that one could tell an intelligent story about and think about under what conditions can this curve go up or down, and really no conversation whatsoever in these papers about that. So we should do better. We should be able to have wider view of the enterprise that we're all immersed in than this. Otherwise, we pretty much consign ourselves to a future of great investment in things, high hopes, and this perpetual cycle of reform and rebound. So that's really what I want to say by way of framing, and then recognize that we are on the precipice of a really big moment here. The health insurance exchanges have opened despite the government being closed, and you know that was the big story a couple weeks ago. The day after this sort of New York Times intro to the health insurance guides, the next day, that was in the you know health section. In the business section was this story: as some companies turn to health exchanges, GE seeks a new path. And if you read this article, it just gives you the tip of the iceberg of a story that I was really delighted to see that it was one of the most emailed and blogged. I don't know about blog, but certainly one of the most emailed articles showing that there is a demand out there for another narrative that isn't just about insurance and what the government is doing or shouldn't do, but what companies and other actors in regions see it in their own interest to do. And so beneath that sort of quickie article is a story about General Electric, which has a healthy imagination sort of business portfolio, which should, you know, is no surprise, is partly about employee health. It's partly about the goods and services and technologies that they sell as GE. And then in the middle is this this role that they have as partner for innovation, addressing major unsolved problems through collaboration. And they have picked specific cities where they have put a major muscle behind the idea of being an architect of how the health system reform can work. And in Cincinnati, this is probably one of the shining examples of how this can work. There is at the core a well-established health collaborative that is a forum for multi-stakeholder engagement, reaching pretty far into the major organizational representatives of the region. There's the Health Bridge, one of the oldest and best health information exchanges in the country. It's been around for 15 years at least. The Health Council is a forum for all of the major hospitals to talk together about how they are positioning that sort of capital service in the region. GE is not the only employer at the table. Big roles for Procter & Gamble and Kroger, which are located in Cincinnati. The health plans are there. A whole array of provider organizations and the health departments, the elected officials, and a variety of national partners, including Robert Wood Johnson and the Health and Human Services. So the footprint of what's going on in Cincinnati is worth studying because of just how aggressively they are working to realign how care is delivered, how it's paid for, and the conditions that leave people vulnerable to disease and injury. This story is exciting enough where Todd Park, the White House Chief Technology Officer, devoted his TED talk at TEDMED last year to just how exciting it is to see a local group of leaders not look to Washington for a solution, but review their health statistics. In this case, Cincinnati is not the worst of the worst. It's actually pretty average in many ways. And the commitment of going from average to awesome and all the work that's going on by public-private alliances in this region deserves our attention. It's still early in the story, but the fact that this work can proceed and proceed in some ways under the radar screen of most of our attention as we are concerned with shenanigans in Washington, which isn't to say that Washington policy is unimportant, but we can't let that be the sole focus of our work. And of course, it should come as no surprise that if you go out looking for leaders who are interested, in fact, conspicuously committed to being change agents in their region of the country, as we do at Rethink Health, we're really interested to see what people aspire to do in their work and where they run into areas of feeling stuck and what it takes to get unstuck and how you can rethink what's possible, has put us in relationship with a huge array of colleagues who have similar interests, and in just a couple years, several dozen states where there are really important stories unfolding at different stages of development, different levels of intensity. But and that's just our little organization. I guess the thing that these groups all have in common is the fact that they're committed to see change, they're focused on results, they're aware of the actions that they are taking, and they recognize the temptation that when you don't get the results that you want to see, that you you might be drawn into reacting, and meaning to reinforce the very actions that you're already attempting and do so even harder, which in complicated systems that are fraught with dynamic complexity and the tendency to policy resistance is a formula for deepening the rut that you're in, right? So reacting, meaning to do over and over again the thing that you're already doing, tends not to get you much better results beyond certain confined circumstances. Actions are always born out of some thinking, and so what we do within Rethink Health and what a lot of these leaders locally that we learn with is to think about this condition of being dedicated to action, but willing to step back and to question who I'm doing it with, why I'm doing it, the scope of the work that might be involved, the trade-offs that are involved, the time horizons. All those things become open for questioning when you're rethinking as a prelude to further action. And that's really what we're doing. Some groups are so committed to this thinking as an advance guide to action that we've built formal simulation models where they can get together and play out scenarios for change before they go through the hard work of implementing them locally, so that they can rule out strategies that are unlikely to succeed and concentrate on those that have a greater chance of making a difference. And that's just our work. There are networks across this country that I won't take the time to narrate because it's a plenty of acronyms and they all exist for different reasons and different purposes. But the message that you should get, the intuition, is that there is not one venue for pursuing the action agenda that would correct the way this health system functions. It's in many ways unfolding locally across this country, and so we should pay a little bit more attention to exactly what that work entails. And that's backed up by some pretty good evidence. It's not like there's one health system in this country that functions uniformly across the country. We've got this is the era of the Dartmouth Atlas, where we know that there are variations in practice and spending from neighboring counties, and the decisions that one makes in one venue need not necessarily be the same ones that you pursue in a neighboring geography, because you're starting from different histories and different present conditions. That's also true, the very same insight from the county health rankings, where you see the sort of micro geographies of risk and vulnerability that also say that there isn't necessarily one solution to this work, and there must be some nuance in thinking about the regions over which we're taking action and recognizing that they're all differently situated in many ways. This is an era, an unprecedented era, in being able to think about moving from a single national conversation to thinking about nested relationships and being good at moving across scales. This image is a nice one in the sense that the pattern might look the same, the basic geometry of it looks the same, but in one case you're really close up to the details, in one case you're much further away, and we don't want to rest with one stable point of view on our health system. We want to be able to move up and down in terms of understanding its nested structures. So in the spirit of getting closer to one of these groups, I'll tell you a story of work that we've been doing with colleagues in Pueblo, Colorado. This group began much like many others, where the leaders of the core institutions that make up population health and healthcare began to get together and realize that there was just no way that any of them, through their own institutions, were going to be able to work any harder, any faster, any more effectively at the general dysfunction of their system when you look at its performance over time. And they thought that by getting together, they might be able to find ways to align and direct their energies to accomplish things that no one of them could do alone. And this brought them into a membership with the Institute for Healthcare Improvement, Triple Aim in a Region program, dues-paying members of that, and talking about what it might mean to start with a population that is 57th out of 59 in the county health rankings, or with a very fragile safety net system, 40% poverty, and say, what can we do from our constraints and opportunities as we see them to move the system. And very quickly they realized that health and healthcare institutions are not the only people who have a stake in that. And they expanded this conversation to include people from the business community, the chambers of commerce, the schools, elected officials, governments, and others. And so this became a truly Pueblo-wide conversation about what to do, anchored in their vision that we should be able to move health and care and cost and not have to make sort of trade-offs among those, that any solution should be a solution in all of those ways and indeed other metrics as well. They were very good students of the collective impact literature, recognizing that building structures that support them to work together at a regional scale, measurement systems and so forth are all important. What they didn't have was a clear understanding of how Pueblo's health system is structured and what actions they might consider taking and the likely consequences of those and what trade-offs might they be facing. And what they wanted to do before diving into a portfolio of programs and practices and taking what little resources they have and allocating them to a set of activities was to think about the big picture, to understand that they are already building on a platform where there are public health departments, community health centers, hospitals, insurers who do a variety of functions. And now the question is, what can we do together as stewards of this whole region that's above and beyond what we do in our day jobs in many ways? And they forcefully resisted doing anything before they got the governance and structure and strategy clear. And it was out of that conversation that we together built a representation of their health system, a simulation model, lets them ask some of these questions about the dynamics that they might experience, and play out a variety of policy scenarios in order to then focus on a few that they really felt compelling. And this is not really necessary to get into the details of the composition of their strategies, but know that this team spent many months and several hundred scenarios to find ones that had the right mix and composition of results that they felt was a compelling platform for moving forward. And once they had that strategy and structure in place, then they began to say, well, we still can't take action on this because we still are a volunteer effort. We're still meeting only occasionally every now and then because most of us are busy in the daily work of the institutions that are working in a more directed way or very focused way. So they wanted to build a backbone organization. They needed the shared measurement system. They needed a sustainable funding structure so that whatever was getting done at this regional level could actually stick. And it turned out that the Colorado Health Foundation approached them because it was so conspicuous at the very different stance that they were taking toward these questions. And I guess I'll repeat that. The Colorado Health Foundation approached them to say, what can we do and learn about what you're doing? And that morphed into a $750,000 grant that they just received, not to implement the programs and policies that they want to address, but to build the infrastructure that lets them work at this large scale regional level. And that was intentional. It's not as if they don't need money for the other things, but we largely know how to get that money or how to develop it. What we don't know is, what they did not know, is how to get themselves positioned to play at a much higher level. So that's an example of sort of avoiding some of the pitfalls that come out of spreading yourself too thinly, too quickly, without having an infrastructure that keeps the group stable. The next kind of shift in positioning us to have widespread influence in health systems is to move from the idea that there are a grand division of labor and that we can describe that by what medicine does, what public health does, what the social services do, what does education, environment. If we conveniently organize things into sectors, then it becomes harder and harder to see this working together as a system. I'll tell another story of another group which has a different origin, a different motivation for getting into a relationship with each other, and moves in some ways similar directions. This is the Atlanta Regional Collaborative for Health Improvement. It is anchored by three institutions in the Atlanta region, and I'll go slowly over who the three essential conveners are here, because it's an unnatural group in some ways. It was the Georgia Health Policy Center, one of the National Network of Public Health Institutes, with a mission to think in a place-based sort of wide-angle way about the way that health policy is shaped And so it's no surprise that a health policy institute might care about regional health system performance. But then you've also got the United Way and the Atlanta Regional Commission, which is sort of the meta organization over the elected county commissions. And they too saw the need to think regionally about how the health system is functioning because it's so intimately connected with the way that social services and community organizations are positioned and the way that county governments are positioned. The feeling that they were all, that was sort of motivating them was this need to do assessments. Hospitals now under the new IRS rules, not non-profit hospitals, have to do assessments of their local health system and articulate implementation plans. Public health departments that are aspiring to accreditation have to do assessments. Federally qualified health centers also have to do capacity planning assessments. Same for county governments, the reauthorization of the hospital. This map up there is literally a map of just two counties and all of the assessments that were required over the next couple of years. It was 50. In the same sandbox, they were facing 50 simultaneous assessments of population health and health system functioning. And they said there's just got to be a way to do collaborative assessment. And they approached the health departments and hospitals and business leaders and the county commissions and the funding collaborative to say, is there some way that we could just get together and do regional assessments so we're all thinking about the same phenomena and then we can go our separate ways on what to do about it? That was the low bar that they set, and it's a reasonably high bar in some sense. Then they had Andy Young, who is the former mayor of Atlanta, come and speak to them and said, you know, there's really two different Atlantas. There's the Atlanta that decided to pursue nonviolence and economic development and built an airport that then anchored their bid for the Olympics. And there's that Atlanta where we come together and do great things that we couldn't have imagined, you know, doing alone. And then there's the other Atlanta, like the one that has the most disorganized and sprawling transportation system and repeatedly votes down transportation reforms that would integrate and make the regional system work better. And so his question was, which Atlanta is going to show up to the health challenge? Or is it the one that we're going to work together or the one where we're going to pursue, you know, separate fragmentation? And so what that group experienced is actually a common predicament that we see in many regions. You know, it's not so hard to find people who aspire to large impact in the systems that they're embedded in. It's not even so hard to gather all the qualitative and quantitative data and do assessments and describe what we see as the needs. What's a lot harder is the shift from collaborative assessment to collaborative investment. Are there priorities that together we might pursue and much less than put our muscle behind to enact? And that's where, you know, a lot of these initiatives get derailed. And that is driven by a phenomenon that I think we're all pretty aware of now, is this accumulation of evidence that there are ways to make a difference in every frontier of health system performance, in delivery of care, elimination of risks, thinking about the different different exposures and choices among subgroups that drive inequities. There is just a mountain of evidence that there are things that could be done to make a difference. What is very difficult if you're in the position of the Archie Steering Committee leaders is to know, how do we prioritize? If we can't do everything at once, at full strength, where do we start? And are there some places that offer more leverage than others? How are we going to pay for these things and sustain them? How do we anticipate the consequences and trade-offs? And even more importantly, who decides those things? Because our administrative structures, organizational boundaries, they're kind of defined in other ways, and there aren't natural forums for people to get together and think about how it all adds up, how these pieces come together and align or don't align. So the good news is that there are methodologies now that help support that, and it's a different set of sciences that support these kind of trade-off and decision selection issues than the sciences of policy analysis and epidemiology and intervention research that drive the accumulation of evidence in the first place. So I'll tell you stories about dynamic modeling, but that's really one of a class of methods that really stand in solidarity with local leaders and realize that they can't do everything and figure out, you know, how do we make decisions about what to do and what and how to think through the consequences. So one of the things that we do is build, somewhat audaciously, a representation of a local health system. It's a simplified thing, but we think is still a pretty realistic way for people to get a place-based, wide-angle view of the enterprise that they're a part of, and let them propose scenarios that of their own design and play those out against a range of metrics so that it's not just about cost or the quality of care or the health of the population or the productivity of the workforce or equity among subgroups. All of those are legitimate ways to question, is the system working and from whose perspective? So we should have a one-stop shop to be able to say, if we take significant action in this region, how's it going to play out across all the things that we value, or at least many of the things that we value, and talk about to what degree those things are solving several problems or selecting for some at the expense of others. It's anchored to as much evidence as we can put together, and then we render that evidence in a form that lets people test their theories rather than rely on an analyst or some other think tank to narrow in on a conclusion and say, this is what we all ought to do. It's a tool for experimentation in public, in diverse settings. And we call these groups stewardship teams because they take the stance of governing the, or at least thinking about the way that the whole enterprise might unfold over time. I'm not going to narrate the legacy of this other than to say that the ability to build these kinds of tools is not out of our reach. Problem framing is a challenge, and what the real horizon that we crossed with this tool is not so much how to represent a health system in some nuance, but how to render it in a form that's useful to leaders in these at this local level, and to recognize that at some point one national model of how things work is not going to be motivational enough to get the job done. Let me give you a little window into how the model is structured. At the core is sort of a statement about the things you would learn from health services and health systems research, that the health status of a population, its both physical and mental health, drives in some degree the demand for care, and the delivery of that care can improve health to some degree, but it also comes at a cost. And so that the dynamics of this triple aim of how, in what ways can you get better care, better health, and lower cost is sort of at the core of what we're studying here. We also want to be pragmatic and say that if people need care when they're sick, in primary care particularly, but also in other settings, we ought to think about the capacity to meet the demand. And are there long waiting lists of people out there who can't get in to see a primary care provider, in which case they're going to go to an ER? And thinking through carefully, where people get care and is there the demand supply balance in place is a big part of this model. And also recognizing that the health status of a population is never given, and that there are risks and vulnerabilities that are modifiable that could do a lot to determine just how much demand, unnecessary perhaps demand, is being placed on an overburdened and very expensive health enterprise downstream. And we also are pretty clear on the idea that cost is itself a driver of decisions and action. So if you have rising costs, it might cause an employer to abandon employer-based health insurance, which now makes it that much harder for employees to get care, or the medical bankruptcies that we've seen skyrocketing could thrust people into greater poverty and expose them to more risks and vulnerabilities than they otherwise would, purely because the system is not in equilibrium, its costs are getting worse. So that's at the core of this model, but it's not just the calculator of health and economic scenarios. We really want to situate it as a tool for leaders who are intentionally planning to make change. So we want to make statements about the initiatives that they can take and how those initiatives get paid for. So we're pretty specific about a whole menu of initiatives and whether they get paid for by some innovation fund, think of a philanthropic investment, a government grant, a decision by an employer to invest in their own workplace. These are sort of the impetus for certain innovations. Other kinds of initiatives might be triggered by how healthcare is paid for. If you pay for volume, you're going to get a lot more volume of services. If you pay per capita, then suddenly the incentive switch to try to keep costs as low as possible because you're going to get your per capita payment one way or another. So the shift on how payment occurs is one thing. And then in the last 5 years or so, there's been increasing understanding that we can negotiate agreements where if healthcare costs go down, some fraction of those costs might be captured and reinvested to enable these initiatives to continue or to expand beyond what they otherwise would. This is the idea of an accountable care organization or accountable care community if it's operated at a large scale level. So we represent that idea too. So there's some nuance in the way that we talk about what to do and how to pay for it. And And then recognize that health and equity, health and cost are not the only criteria here. Productivity of the workforce, equity among subgroups are also important metrics. It's all situated against a local region, so that, you know, Atlanta's aging structure is different than Pueblo's, and the degree to which people are living in poverty is different. And so we want to recognize the kind of physics of the way that each region might be situated, both in population health and healthcare resources. That involves a pretty extensive paper chase in terms of finding local data where it exists, small area estimates from data sources that are higher. It puts together, as best as we can, a faithful portrait of this entire enterprise, population composition through health status of the population and its demand for care, utilization, and cost. So here's a pop quiz. This is a tough thing, right? How much is the Atlanta region spending on healthcare? Total cost of care is a really tough measure to achieve, as many of you may know. But through this process, we can estimate that rather readily. And so here's a pop quiz. I'm really serious about this. How much do you think these two counties, Fulton and DeKalb County in Atlanta, how much are they spending in 2010 on just personal healthcare services? You can venture guesses if you want. Just yell out the number you think. Seeing a vote for $11 billion in the back. Other votes. What was?
Seven.
You're voting for 11 as well.
Six.
Three, six. Anybody want to vote for the high ones? Right, 3, 6, 11. This was a really tough, even for people who ply their trade in Atlanta, a very tough question. And I think we can agree that the differences between $11 billion and $3 billion are pretty significant. The answer, as best as we can estimate it, is 11. It's a little bit lower than the U.S. average because Atlanta's population is a little bit younger and a little bit less insured, and both of those are reasons why there's less healthcare utilization. So what we do by way of working with leaders is then to say, what if you just took 1% of that $11 billion, if you devoted just 1% of it to do something different than business as usual, you know, what might you be able to get at? And even then, not just 1% in perpetuity, but just a brief innovation fund, 1% for 5 years, what might we be able to get? And that's the challenge that we put to them, and that really in a way that they put to each other. Can we craft scenarios that we think would be really compelling to move the total health system in a dramatic way over time? And you know, we want to do it with reference to our several goals. So improving health is great, but remember that there's a momentum underway already, largely driven by aging and chronic disease, where you know, severe chronic illness is going up, not down. And so if you want to improve health, it's against this future that we're anticipating. Or if you want to enhance care, then recognize that only a fraction of care that's delivered now meets guidelines, and that's been eroding, not getting better. Also, in these are sort of weighted averages. Different subgroups get better care than others, but when you roll it up together, it's a pretty mediocre picture of the adherence to guidelines and the ability for people to participate in their own self-care. Healthcare costs, I need not narrate. Its slope is pretty scary. Equity is another lens into this, and so you've got the disadvantaged fraction of the population in Atlanta having eroded through the recession and getting worse, and that doesn't just reverse quickly. So we've got something like 35% of the population living in poverty, and every health metric attributable to the disadvantaged is higher. They have more severe illness, more uncontrolled, untreated mental illness, more deaths. And it's entrenched. This has not been changing very easily. And so if you want to move equity, you're going to have to do something about the size of the disadvantaged group and the fact that they are systematically less healthy and not getting anywhere near as good care. There's also the lens of just the straight economics of the region. All this sickness is taking a toll in absenteeism and presenteeism, and so there's lost productivity, and that's getting worse. And so even if you're not a health professional, you might care about that. So we offer a menu of options that give people, so we're now narrowing the landscape of all the things you can do in a health system to just a couple dozen that are the ones that we can develop good evidence for and render in a form that's interactive and testable. So there are a suite of things that one might do upstream around behavioral policy, environmental hazards, crime, socioeconomic policies. There are many things to do to improve the quality of care and not just what the providers do, but what people can do in their own lives. The capacity I emphasized can be addressed through more efficiency or more recruitment in terms of getting, you know, in some cases, you just don't have enough people, no matter how efficient they can be. And in other cases, efficiencies might alleviate capacity bottlenecks. A list of things that have been proposed or well implemented in other regions to lower the cost of care, everywhere from eliminating waste or planning to reduce readmissions into hospitals or screening out potential visits that might otherwise be handled at home or in other venues. So lots of stuff underway of cost. I'll just say one word about trends is that, you know, local regions are often experiencing consequences of policy choices that come above. This is their nested relationship to larger structures. So, you know, the ways that insurance expansion might unfold in the Atlanta region isn't really a decision that leaders in Atlanta only will make, but they will have to contend with, you know, the decision to expand Medicaid insurance or not. And that's a thing to contend with. And then how are they going to pay for all this? So the essential questions that we ask are what to do, how do you want to pay for it, and how proud would you be, which is a really important question because it drives iteration. If you're not happy enough with the actions that you know immediately how to pay for, then you might get more creative, and that's a reason for rethinking before going ahead and doing the minimal, is to say, you know, can we actually get to awesome somehow, and who else would we need to be in alignment with? So the conversation is about directionality. Where are we headed, the timing and magnitude of these impacts? And that's yet another of these segues of saying we don't want to just have goals. We want to be 5%, you know, lower cost by 5% or improve health and equity by 6% by some date. Goals are fine, but we really want to know how to get there from where we are. We want to know the path from here to there more so than just the aspiration of where to be. It's not unlike this cartoon. It captures it nicely where, you know, people are differently situated, facing a system we don't fully understand. Things get better when we talk to each other, and there's a lot of energy going into forming coalitions where people can, you know, kind of pool their understanding and make conscious decisions about what to do together. It's even better if you can get some kind of overview of how the system is designed. If you can have a design perspective on things and develop the foresight to imagine if we took this path or that, what might happen. And so this is the style of conversation that puts us into a relationship, not just with future state, but the path from here to there. So we can talk about lots of pathways. We can talk about the pressures and opportunities we might face to pursue them, and we can play out these alternative consequences. So just to give you a quick illustration of how this works, let's pretend that people were good scholars of 30 years of public health literature, and they would realize that investing in healthier behaviors is a pretty wise thing to do. It's the principal driver of a lot of morbidity and mortality and cost, and it's pretty modifiable. When you look down the list of major drivers of disease and injury, you've got tobacco, nutrition, physical inactivity, violence, substance abuse. These are all things that can be moved. Not by a magic wand. We're not saying, you know, with this scenario that you're going to make everybody's behavior perfect. You're saying, to the extent that we've seen other interventions accomplish, you know, progress in this region, let's imagine that kind of effort here. And we'll do so with this sort of simple statement of, you know, invest just 1% of what we're spending on the whole enterprise for just a few years, a temporary innovation fund, what might you get? So that's a good question for you. If you have a full court press on behavior in Atlanta, with all that I've told you, how big a dent do you think it's going to make on some of these major impacts that we hope to see? How strong? How long might it take? You know, just what kind of a magnitude of an impact would you hope to see? If you put, let that number go by pretty quickly, right? So 1% of 11 billion is 100 million. Let's do so for just 5 years. So we're going to put 500 million on the table to invest in a serious effort in behavior change. That would make the cover of the Atlanta Journal-Constitution if that money were devoted. So the question is, what would you expect to see out of that over time? It's not an easy question to answer. In fact, the psychic pain that you're feeling is one that we put people through in workshops. The paper and pencil on these graphs saying, put your finger on the year 2012 and draw a line of just how fast do you think this is going to move the death rate, or just what kind of an impact do you see it having on cost, or or equity. And those are tough conversations, and for time, I won't force us to do this, but I think you can warm up to the idea that we don't have really well-developed mental skills to think through how an action that we might even understand, as little as I've characterized it, would roll up into these summary measures of system performance. But I can assure you there will be an effect. Everything does connect to everything, and these things do move. The question is, how do we understand what we're likely to get? And so the virtues of simulation models, rightly or wrongly, help us to play out this. And so here's a high-level dashboard that you don't have to even read. Just squint your eyes and see that it's all green. Everything in these categories of health and care and cost and equity, productivity, it's all green. Everything's moving in a direction that we'd like it to go, which is not an easy thing to accomplish. Many policies, you know, have their strengths in one area and they have drawbacks in others. And so when you have an initiative that, you know, moves the agenda forward in every domain that you've named at once, that's actually a pretty rare thing. On the other hand, these are relatively small, so if you move beyond squinting and look at these numbers, they're all single digits. For $500 million, I might have hoped to see more than this. And so we can look deeper and see the course, right? So not just where did we end up, but what was the path to get there? And this is a quickie sort of trace of in 2012, we're investing in this, and it gets stronger and stronger and stronger for about 8 years, and then starts to rebound. Any thoughts on why that might have happened? What's going on to see this kind of profound beginning progress and strong rebound? Any theories on that one? Yeah, so Jackie's saying that this was a temporary investment of 5 years, and you know, the amazing thing with that temporary investment is that we see visible impacts a full 28 years out, right? So this thing is showing its impact in the region relative to the baseline nicely, but it was going away in part because the funding went away. And that's exactly what happened here. The spending on this effort was a full court press for a brief period of time, and you saw some response, but as that investment erodes or vanishes, eventually you see gradual rebound. So this was a budget collapse in 1 year that then took decades to see its full consequences going out. And I'll just say that, you know, ordinarily, if you start to see this kind of rebound out here, what happens organizationally, right? People look for somebody to blame, some decision that happened out here in the 2020s when the seeds of this rebound were built into the way this thing was started on day one. And so the tendency to look local in time for a reason why suddenly this impact is now eroding is almost always going to be scapegoated on somebody near and time and space when it really was a structural problem. And it's true for a lot of things that we want to see be sustained. Healthier behaviors, economic and social policies, mental illness, self-care. These are things that you can't just do and hope the system sticks. They have to be there, you know, to have secular changes over decades, more than anything to be accomplished in 5 years. So the funding is really the root of this, and there's a handful of choices we can make. We can shrink the effort. We can just cut back and say, you know, $500 million was scattered too far, too fast, and we'll shrink this down and do less. Don't try to do as much. In some ways, erode our goals. That's one way to have your money go further. The other way is just to ask for more money. $500 million wasn't going to get it done. Let's do it $50 million and just, you know, put more into it. That would be in the category of reacting and doing more of the same intensively, but not recognizing the inherent problem of the instability of this. The other way to do it is recognizing that cost was among the things that this behavioral initiative moved. And so if you're lowering healthcare costs, you know, whose money is that, really? You know, maybe we can enter into some complicated arrangement where some fraction of those healthcare savings are then reinvested to sustain this initiative over time. And that's not like just a fantasy. There are multiple shared savings arrangements being enacted now under Medicare, Medicaid, private insurers. Lots of people from important institutions have recognized that this is a reinforcing dynamic that is not present ordinarily, but could be built into our systems, and what would happen if we do. And so the model lets us represent that. If we can end up, you know, saying that if by this behavioral initiative we save money at any point in time against the benchmark, you know, what fraction would be retained? We say 50-50 held by the insurer, 50-50 come back to the community enterprise. If we do nothing more than that, We still have our Reform and Rebound in red, as we had, but now we're looking at the green line where there's this reinvestment deal in place. And now we see sort of the fuller expression of what this initiative could accomplish. It's delayed, its impacts are minimal in the short term, but get stronger and stronger and stronger, as we've seen with lots of other behavioral stories that where there is a continued investment. So again, not a magic wand. There's still upwards of 25% high-risk behavior, but it's substantially changed over the course of a couple decades. This reinvestment deal, just warm up to the magnitudes here, we had $500 million against an $11 billion annual enterprise, and this 50-50 deal brings back almost $2 billion of resources. That's how expensive healthcare is. That's how much of a dent behaviors could plausibly have in it. And that lets us mount, you know, close to a $1.9 billion investment with just the small startup capital. It becomes self-reliant because it is this progressively, it has a progressive influence on cost, and the commitment to rely only on that from this point forward can generate a tremendous amount of resources. And now we see, with that condition, double-digit impacts on deaths, mental illness and physical illness, even changes in the way the care is delivered, because now lots of people who could be kept out of the disease care delivery system are not there, and its capacities are available for people to take better advantage of, and a much bigger dent on cost. So the story there is, you know, it's a sort of not all instant. In the beginning, you have to make a commitment to the capital investment to get this serious behavioral change initiative in place, and that's something on the order of $50 per capita. But then over time, and you know, it's under 8 years in this case, where you start to cross a threshold, and the savings get bigger and bigger and bigger the longer you're at that, to the point where you're yielding quite a bit of money. And the ROIs are on the order of eight to one or 9 to 1 on behavior, on healthcare costs, and then the employers forget just the dollars delivered in healthcare. The greater productivity of a healthier population is experienced in more workers and more people being able to be more productive at work. So that's just a glimpse into the kind of pathway stories that we can examine. When we let 80 people in Atlanta sit together and develop scenarios, they can develop all kinds of competing theories. And when you look at them arrayed out, we ask them, you know, of all the things that you've proposed, is there some of this that looks like a stronger foundation than others? And we gave them all instant voting technology, and in the room, this was the result. There was one package of a handful that were tested where 87% of these people who come from all over the universe, and many of them not even healthcare professionals, could agree that, you know, if we're going to pursue a regional scenario, if we're going to be the Atlanta that dealt with racism, that decided to pursue a sort of nonviolent response to social change, decided to build an economy that was anchored with the Olympics and the airport, that Atlanta, if we're going to behave like that at all, how would we make shared choices? And the fact that 87% of these people on one day could agree on anything was pretty impressive. And even more impressive is what they did next. They spent 9 months organizing into new teams to study what would it mean to bring that behavioral policy into reality. You know, what would it mean to enter into this kind of shared savings arrangement? What do we know about that? And what would the opportunities and obstacles look like? Five teams wrote a playbook that's 50 some odd pages and have been meeting through countless hours to really take seriously the idea that they might now move from assessment to shared investment. And this is where I want my story to end, is you know, for much of public health planning and policy making, we begin with the presumption of scarcity. And what if that scarcity were not the limiting factor? What if it weren't? I'm not saying that resources aren't important. I'm just saying that for a predicament that is described as a health disadvantage for the richest country in the world, it may not be that we lack the resources. It may be that we're not using those resources or not aligning them very well. And this little story I've showed makes a pretty compelling case for that. So if we shift from thinking about scarcity to abundance,